5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sure.
Deal.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show.
Do Sasquatch bury their dead? I know this is a question a lot of people ask. A lot of people, the main question when talking about Bigfoot, and a lot of skeptics out there, the main question people ask is, why don't we find any bones? And so this week I thought what we'd do is discuss Sasquatch and possible burial sites for the show. I know before we get to that, we had Robert call in from Washington State with an encounter he wanted to share on the show. So what I thought we'd do is bring Robert on first, have him share his encounter with us, and then we'll get into our topic for this evening. What do you guys think?
Sounds good.
One thing I want to do is mention, I want to thank Joe Zerat out there for the new cover art. A lot of people, if they notice on iTunes and on our Facebook, they'll see the new cover art. So I really want to thank Joe for sending that out to us. I know, Will, you're wondering if maybe he could do a little artwork for you for your upcoming book.
Yeah, I've actually got three projects I'm working on that would I've been looking for somebody who wouldn't mind doing a little bit of sketch work for me. And, you know, speaking of people that have contacted us various times, I want to say hi to Bruce in Scotland. Really, he asks a lot of questions, but it's great because it really gets my mind working, you know, digs up things that I've forgotten, you know, years ago. So thanks, Bruce. Glad you're on board with us.
Yeah, Bruce is the man. I know he sent us a lot of love on Facebook. I also want to thank Melanie West. We did a story last week, or I'll take the blame for it, about Gigantopithecus in Canada, and it was a spoof website. Melanie West sent us the update on it, letting us know it was a spoof website. So sorry, everyone, about the news story. Well, let's go ahead and bring Robert on and hear his story, and then let's get into our topic.
Okay. Hi, Robert. Very nice to make your acquaintance.
Good to meet you, Will.
I don't know if you know much about me, but I've actually encountered Sasquatches twice myself, once when I was 16 and another time when I was about 30. The first time was at very close up, within 15 feet of two of them. You know, knew the world famous Sasquatch hunters personally and have done this for over 40 years now. So, and out of respect for your anonymity, we'll only mention your first name, and if you wish, any of the names of locations or anything else, you know, we won't mention that. We'll just say, you know, if you wanted to say Washington or the Northwest, we can refer to the areas as that.
I don't mind disclosing where it was. I don't hunt that area anymore.
Okay.
I don't mind if people go up there and snoop around. It's actually a beautiful country.
Let's start out by talking about the subject of Bigfoot itself. Prior to this incident, had you any sort of knowledge about this subject or...
Yes.
Maybe what was your thinking about it at that time?
Well, at the time, I wasn't sure if it was actually true or not. I guess I tended to believe it was possible. And I know my dad showed me an article and in the paper, I think it was back in 1974, and we were at Fort Lewis at that time. On the front of the paper was a picture of the Patterson-Gilman video. That's my first introduction to it. I didn't know if Dad was pulling my leg, trying to scare me or whatever. You know, I had no idea at the time what it was. And so as years went on, I guess I read a couple of books on it, still not totally convinced, but it was interesting, to say the least. And
leading up to this, your incident, what were you doing at that time?
I was hunting, and there was a group of us bow hunting deer over in eastern Washington on the other side of Chinook Pass. I'd bow hunt deer there in September, and then I'd hunt elk with a rifle around St. Helens in November. This dates way back to 1987, I believe it was, and I intended to spend 9 days up there. My friends were going to just spend the weekend, go home, and then come back for the next weekend. We'd sit around the campfire and talk and tell scary little stories and stuff like that. And one of the guys that was up there with us, he had his fiance camping with us. And Saturday night, she kept hearing things around camp in the middle of the night. And she was afraid to get up, I guess, and go to the bathroom. And when she told us about it the next day, we just all assumed she heard deer or something around camp. We absolutely did not take it serious. We just assumed she was unfamiliar with what she was hearing.
It was just something walking around, or was there some kind of vocalizations, or?
No. It was just noise. Something walking around, moving around camp. So, and like I said, we just all assumed it was deer or something. It was no big deal. The next day, everybody left that afternoon. And so I was up there by myself. There was a horse camp that was, I don't know if I told Wes or not, but there was a horse camp that was camped a couple hundred yards up towards the end of this road. And that's pretty much where the road dead ends and turns into, heads over to the William O. Douglas Wilderness area. They had packed up and left too. I was completely alone up there. There was no other camps. And back then, bow hunting wasn't quite as popular as it is today either. I'm not spooked. I'm not, there's nothing there to intimidate me, basically, and I go about my business and hunt that evening. Get back to camp, after dark, I make my dinner, relax, settle in for the night, get in my sleeping bag, and I think I was reading a map or something, and by the time I turned my lantern off, it didn't take long. Let me kind of just give you a description of, I was camped in a hairpin turn. Just before the last hairpin turn on the 1500 road. Just a few hundred yards up from there, it dead ends. And like I said, it borders the wilderness area. I was camped right in the hairpin. And as I turned my lantern off, I laid down, and all of a sudden I heard something walk across the road. And it was on 2 feet, and it was loud. And it came from the opposite side into my side of the road. It startled me, and I sat straight up in my sleeping bag wondering what the hell I just heard. I'm listening. I can't hear anything. And then I can start hearing branches and stuff move, and it seemed like they were getting closer and closer to my tent. I couldn't hear footsteps then. I still don't know what I'm listening to. All I know is something came across the road. It was on two legs. And it had a heavy step, but once it got onto my side, it was quiet. But like I said, I'm starting to hear it approach. I'm kind of nervous. I'm unarmed at the time. Back then, you couldn't be armed when you were bow hunting in the field, and so I had no guns with me at the time, and a little unnerved by all this. And suddenly, it must have been right outside my tent. I had my cooler set up by my tent, and it must have kicked my cooler, because my cooler spun around and slammed into the side of my tent. That scared the hell out of me, and I grabbed a machete. That was the only thing that I had there next to me that I could defend myself with. I remember grabbing the machete and holding on to this, and this thing had to have been so close. I didn't smell it. I couldn't hear it walk. I couldn't hear it breathe, but I swore it could hear my, I thought it could hear my heartbeat. Then after the cooler it walked over, it must have walked over to where I had my kitchen set up, and I remember hearing my Coleman gas can hit the ground. And it wasn't a pop from expansion. I don't know if you've ever dealt with them as the sun goes up and down, and, you know, right. The temperature change, they'll pop sometimes. This wasn't a pop. It hit the ground. And then it walked over towards my car, which is about 10 yards away from the tent. And once again, I did hear it go through the brush, or there was another tree over by the car. And if I'm not mistaken, it was about maybe 10 foot high. And it still had boughs that were relatively close to the ground. It sounded like it was moving up against it, almost like, and it probably sounds ridiculous, but it almost sounded like it was using it for possible cover or I don't know, but I could hear the branches move. And it may have touched the car, but I don't even know how long all this lasted. It must have, its curiosity was done with me, and it walked back across the road and went down into a gully about 100 yards below me. This whole time, I don't know what I'm hearing. I'm trying to make sense of what I'm listening to. All I know is this thing was on two legs. I don't understand what could have snuck through my camp like that, picked up the gas can and dropped it. Like I said, I never heard any sound once it was in camp. I never smelt anything. I didn't hear it breathe. But now I'm listening to this thing about 100 yards below me in a gully, and it starts tearing a log apart or a stump. To my relief, I started convincing myself that's a bear. Mm-hmm. It's got to be a bear. He's tearing a stump apart. So, okay, you're getting all worked up over nothing. It's just a bear. Relax. And I did try to relax. And I'm a little upset thinking about this stuff. You guys got me all scared. So after a little while, the noise stops. It stops tearing the tree apart. I hear nothing, but then suddenly it's coming back up the hill, and it's coming up on 2 feet, and that is no doubt. And I thought, you know, this, I don't know what the hell is going on, but I've had enough. And I turned the lantern on real quick. It had an electric switch. Turned the lantern on. I slid my boots on. I didn't even lace them. And I got out of the tent. I ran for the car. Got into the car, and in my mind, I thought that by the time I've done all this and got into my car, it had to be right there at the road or right next to camp again. And I remember not wanting to see whatever it was, and I slammed my mirror, broke my rearview mirror off, basically. The lantern is still lit between me and the steering wheel. I basically did a 12-mile race down the mountain on this logging road back down to Highway 410. The way this gully and this canyon work, and the road runs parallel to Cowpuncher Ridge, I kept thinking this thing was going to intersect me somewhere between before I got down far enough, before I got down to McDaniels Lake. I kept thinking this thing's going to run down. It can come down the side of this mountain and intersect me. And I really was afraid. And but like, keep in mind, I had this lantern in between me and the steering wheel, and I'm racing down the mountain like the Dukes of Hazzard. And I didn't even shut this lantern off until I got down to Highway 410, kind of collected myself, shut the lantern off, and thought about this. And then I drove home. I lived in Tacoma, and I remember making it back to Tacoma in an hour and a half. Got in kind of late that night and talked to my girlfriend at the time. And, of course, she was skeptical. I wasn't sure what I was talking about and didn't really want to believe what I was saying. But I grabbed a little sleep. The next morning I got up early. I grabbed a 12-gauge and my .06, and I went back up to camp.
Before you go into going back, Woody, doesn't it remind you of our encounter when you hear footsteps and a million things go through your mind and you think, okay, is this a bear? Okay, it's not a bear. Is this a deer? Okay, it's not a deer. Is this a person? Okay, that doesn't make sense either. Doesn't it kind of remind you a little bit of our encounter of hearing the footsteps and realizing, I mean, a million things go through your mind and you think, Jesus, what is this thing?
Right.
Yeah, no, it does. It totally reminds me of so many emotions going through your head, and you don't know quite what's out there, but how should you react? And I think that's the biggest thing is you don't know exactly what to do because you don't know exactly what you're hearing. So, yeah, no, you're doing great, Robert. This is a great interview. I'm really involved in it.
27 years later, and I'm sitting here. I'm still nervous about it. You know, I really am. Well, it's like you were talking about. I wasn't quick to think, well, this is a Bigfoot. That's not what I was thinking when I was listening to all this. I'm actually trying to figure out what the hell this really truly is, besides a Bigfoot. You know what I mean? Let's find a rational explanation for what's going on out here.
Maybe I'm hearing it wrong. Maybe it's something that I'm missing.
Right.
You know, when you're listening.
And that's why when it started carrying the tree apart down in the gully, I thought, okay, now it's a bear, and
right.
I'm just confused about what's going on around camp. But that is definitely a bear. But like I said, when it quit the tree and came back up once again, now it was coming up, it was coming at a fast pace up the hill, and it was on two legs, and there was no ifs, ands, or buts about that. And like I said, it was more than I could stand. I wasn't going to wait for round two. I didn't know what it was going to do, and I didn't know what it was. And I thought, for sure, hunters don't do this. You don't play games with other hunters, and I know I wouldn't screw with another man's camp. I think it's a dangerous and stupid thing to do. And so, I mean, I actually considered that it was that it could be a hoax, you know, but...
I used to hunt those areas, too. I'm from Puyallup, and
okay. People
just didn't do that. They didn't do that in that area.
And especially,
you're right,
back,
you don't mess with another man's camp.
Right. You get yourself shot. And
yeah, you identify yourself and very clearly come into somebody's camp, you know,
right.
Because everybody's armed.
Like I said, I'm still nervous about this.
It never goes away.
You
never get over it.
It took me years to be able to like I said, it was two or three years before I could actually hunt the prime time again, be out in the woods as the sun came up. And wait till after dark before I actually was out of the woods again, you know. That took a long time for me to do. I was scared to death of the dark out there. If I could not see, I didn't want to be out there.
Now, when you went back up to the camp the next day, what did you find?
Absolutely nothing. Nothing was disturbed. And I could see the cooler slammed into the tent. I could see the gas can laying on its side. But other than that, I couldn't see anything. Nothing was missing. Yeah, nothing was missing. There was a smudge on the car, and it looked like it possibly might be a hand. But I don't know. I can't be certain about that. But other than that, in the daylight, everything seemed normal. I couldn't find any tracks because the ground's kind of hard up there in pine needles, and it's dry over there. And so tracks are going to be difficult. I tried to calm myself. I went hunting. And so this was what, Sunday? No. Hell, I don't even know what day it is anymore. It's Monday now. And I went ahead and went hunting. I stayed near camp. I didn't go far, but I was out of the timber before dark. I was back in camp watching the sun go down. I got a little nervous about it, but I tried to maintain my composure and tried to figure out, okay, night I'm armed, I'm all right. We're going to figure out what's going on. I don't want something to ruin my hunting, like I was telling Wes. I mean, I love to hunt. I want to make sure that I fully understand what's going on. I don't want something crazy to ruin my hunting. So anyways, I convinced myself that it was possibly a prank and did my routine, ate. I went back to bed, lantern on for a little bit, and then I heard what... When you come up the 1500 road, you got Bethel Ridge on one side, you got Cowpuncher Ridge on my side.
Mm-hmm.
Any vehicles that are coming, you can hear them echo for miles.
For miles, right. I know that area.
And so as I'm laying there, I start hearing this car. I'm thinking, all right, okay, it is a prank. You watch. These guys are going to come in here after dark like they're doing now. They're going to shut the car down, and then the game's going to begin. So that's what I was expecting. And, the car ended up being my brother, my girlfriend's brother-in-law. And he was in camp with us initially Saturday and Sunday. He'd left Sunday. He had talked to Angela, and she told him what happened, and he had to come see for himself. So he came into camp. I explained everything to him. And by now, I'm so exhausted. I'm tired. I haven't slept. And, you know, the stress and So I'm trying to get some sleep. I'm not hearing anything yet. And I remember Mike asking me, he says, what time did this happen last night? And I says, what time is it? I think he said 9:30 or something like that. And I said, and jokingly, I told him he's late. And I started dozing off. By that time, Mike shakes me again. Robert, did you hear this? Did you hear this? Listen. I'm listening, and you can hear movement down on the other side of the hairpin again. But now you're hearing what I called, at that time, I called it gibberish. They were chattering. It was talking. The other thing that was really peculiar about this is I was telling Wes that when this thing was talking, I'm not sure if it was, you heard a clicking sound, but I don't know if it was clicking from its tongue in cheek or if it was clicking like stones together, if that makes sense. And it would had an intense voice. It wasn't that it was overly loud or anything, but it was intense, a very strong voice, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And as soon as he would, I'm going to try, I don't know if I, don't laugh at me, but I'm going to try to mimic a little bit of kind of what I was hearing. And it sounded almost and with clicking going on while he was doing this. I thought it was like, another way I described it was like somebody speaking Russian backwards, if that made sense too.
And, right, right.
And as soon as he stopped, another one would pipe off, right, about probably 20, 30 yards up from him. And he would respond to that. And then a third one would put in his two cents. And so we were semi-surrounded by these things, and they were just on the other side of the road. They couldn't have been no more than 30 yards from us. I imagine they were even closer. I'm just saying they couldn't have been any further than that. They seemed to stay stationary. Occasionally you'd hear stuff move around, but I didn't feel so threatened. It was intense. It was incredible to hear what I'm hearing. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. Mike would, then it shut down, and Mike stayed, he was just awake, he was my sentry. I kept, once it slowed down a little bit, I would doze off, and then Mike would wake me up again. You got to hear this, and we'd listen to this stuff again. And this went on. There was at one point, Mike wanted to leave. He couldn't handle it anymore, and he wanted me to shoot warning shots to my tent. I thought, absolutely not. That's not going to happen. I didn't feel threatened enough to shoot, but scared enough to where I didn't dare. And I don't know what's going on, and I don't know what this is. What if it's people? You know what I mean? I don't want to shoot somebody, and I don't know what I'm shooting at. I'm not pulling the trigger. After a while, he suggested we leave, and that he would hold the flashlight. We could, and I'd take the guns, and he'd get us to the car. And I thought, I'm not leaving, Mike. I says, if they come across the road, you wake me up. Wake me up if you hear anything on that road or come across the road. Please wake me up. Then it's going to be a different story. But they never did. But they stayed there till almost daylight the next day. And I don't know if they were observing us or I don't know what the hell they were doing. I really don't. I just know they scared the hell out of me. They scared the hell out of Mike so bad that Mike's never gone back in the woods to camp. And this was almost 30 years ago. He grew up in out country over here by Hart's Lake, not too far from Fort Lewis and so forth. And
right.
He understands what goes on, but it spooked him bad, and it spooked me bad. Like I said, it just about ruined my hunting, taking me years to kind of get over it. And I don't think you really do, because I'm not over it now speaking to you. And
no, you don't. You never. It's something that kind of gets burned into your mind, and you can't shake it. I think it's so different than anything anyone could experience that it stays fresh with you all your life.
It really does. And I mean, it's like I said, 27 years, and I still hunt. I force myself out in the woods. I do my thing. The fear isn't as bad. I can actually think about this stuff now when I'm out there. I don't feel threatened. I don't know. That's because I haven't seen
the chattering noises you mentioned about. And I don't know if you're familiar with the Ashford area by Mount Rainier.
Yep.
My buddies and I used to camp up near Copper Creek, and.
Okay.
one night. Now, there had Sasquatches do move around through those areas. In fact, all that whole region. And I could spend hours talking to you about the different areas and different things that have happened in those regions. But over in the Copper Creek area, about 2005, 2006, we were camped up there for a couple of nights. And we were sitting around the fire, four or five of us, one evening after we'd gone into Ashford and had dinner. And about 100 yards above us on the ridge, we heard chattering very similar to what you described. And about 40 feet or so to the right of where we heard this noise coming from, and it was the weirdest noise. And I've heard a lot of different Sasquatch noises over the years, usually screams, whistles, things like that. But this chattering, the other individual was making almost chimp-like noises. Not hooting like an owl, but a hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo kind of a noise in response to the chattering the other one was making. And they did the same thing. They stayed up there. One was moving back and forth. We could hear it as it moved back and forth, making its utterances. And the other one stayed pretty stationary. But they stayed up there for hours. And I guess they were just watching us sit around the fire. That's the only thing we could figure. And I've also experienced being surrounded in a camp out on the Squally River near Roy. Back in 1976, you know, where they stayed until just before daylight. In fact, we were teenagers at the time, the group of us, and we couldn't get any more firewood, so we were exhausted and finally leaned up next to a big log and went to sleep, and I guess they got bored with us and left. You know, those experiences are, I think you're lucky, you know, if you come out of it unscathed, because, you know, these guys can be violent sometimes, and, but in your case, you know, in ours too, I think they were just checking you out, seeing what was going on. Up on that 1500 road, I've talked to a number of people that have had experiences in that area over the years, so there has definitely been some experiences up there.
You're talking to three guys that have witnessed Bigfoot firsthand, and we've heard, with West and I's encounter, we've heard growling, breathing, we've seen them move in front of us, so don't hold back anything. I'm really appreciating your encounter. So don't feel like you're on the spot or anything like that. But I want to let you know we really do appreciate your encounter. But the question is, 27 years later today, how has this changed your life? Is there anything that you look differently, maybe going hunting or out in the woods type thing?
I think I'm a lot more brave than I was a few years ago. I mean, I don't know if it's just because it's maybe it was that one time thing, and maybe I'm not totally convinced, or I've talked myself out of it. I've done everything because I go through this every year when I'm hunting. Sometimes not when I'm hunting. I'm just sitting around, and the thoughts come back, and you run through this. And you want to make sure that you're not jumping to conclusions. You're not making something up. That I haven't convinced myself that it's something that it's not. I do believe that these things exist. Even though I probably had the opportunity to go out and look at one, I wasn't about to get out and see that. It was just not for me. But today, I am a lot more brave when I'm out there, and I can walk around in the woods at night. I can do what I have to do. That monkey's on, no pun intended, that monkey's still on my back, though, you know what I mean? I'm a lot more aware, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think all of us that have encountered one, you know, your senses are definitely a little more heightened when you're out in the forest afterwards, because you know there's a little bit more out there than what you thought there was beforehand.
Sure.
Like I said, I don't think it ever hurts to pay more attention out in the forest anyway.
Well, no, it really doesn't, you know, but you know, when you're younger and your primary goal is to get a deer, get an elk, you know, you're hunting and you're invincible, you have a gun, you're the apex predator, but I don't feel like that anymore. You know,
you hit that right on the nail, because I used to carry a .357 in a shoulder holster and my .300 Savage, and I hunted deer and elk, and I did the same thing. You know, when I was young, I was out by myself, go for miles, cross country. You know, I felt like I was invincible until I saw two of these things up close. You know, it really changes your perspective about where you are in the pecking order of nature.
I would like to see one. I just want to see it on my terms. And I just want to be absolutely convinced of what I heard. if that makes sense. I just want for my own satisfaction. And I just want to see these things. But at the same time, once again, what's it going to do to my hunting if the reality of that is absolute fact? There's no disputing it no more. It's 100% factual. These things really, really do exist. I can't deny it anymore. How am I going to feel about hunting after that? And
I think it depends on how you choose to approach it.
Because I hunt, I know you guys are, I hunt up by Indian Heavens, I understand you familiar with that area?
I worked that area for 12 years, and Wes and Woody are in that area.
Okay. And I hunt up there a lot since the 70s. That's elk camp up there. And, you know, we had to earn our way into elk camp. And Dad used to drop me off there at Indian Heavens, 10 miles away from camp, and I'd work my way back. You know, sometimes up on the ridge road above what we call the ridge road 3220, I believe it is, up above Skookum Meadows.
Right, right. There's some nice little herds of elk in there.
Oh, there's plenty of elk in there, and it's big, big country. And I always thought that all the cross country crud that I do up there, the places I go up there, and the things that I've done, I can't imagine not seeing one if they're there. If that makes sense. And
well, you know, they're around that area, but you got to be in the right part of that region at certain times of the year, because of the way they move through that region.
And I thought about that. Like, because right now it should be piling up full of snow. And usually in the winter, right, you get about 5 feet of snow up there. And I don't care how big these things are. I mean, there's no reason for them to be there. It's going to be too hard. There's no food. There's no reason for them to be up there. And you have basically a limited time, like you said, you know, to be up there. And it's once when the conditions are right up there and you've got millions of huckleberries, you've got wild strawberries, there's plenty of animals up there. I don't see why I couldn't survive up there or go through. But I've never encountered a Bigfoot up there. At least I don't think I have. I did tell Wes about getting dropped off on the Squaw Butte Trail, and just before you start coming down it into Skookum Meadows, it was snowing, it was foggy as hell. You know how it gets up there, it gets dense.
Oh, yeah.
I'm on the trail, and something stopped me and caught my eye, and I went back to look in. I'm looking at a figure, but it looked like a figure of somebody standing there, and it had its arm. It looked like its arm was kind of stretched out towards a tree, and it looked like I caught it in mid-stride, and it stopped and froze. And that was my perception of what I saw right there. Right. But I could not make out any detail in the fog, and I wasn't going to go in there any closer and look at it. I was I put the binoculars on it. I couldn't make out anything. Put the rifle on it, dialed the scope up as far as I could. Still couldn't make out anything. And I just left, convinced myself that's just a odd combination of branches and logs, and just happens to look like that. And I went ahead and went on down in the Skookum Meadows. But that was the only thing that I've ever seen or dealt with up there.
You know, that area is so grassy, and the ground is hard. It's kind of tough for tracks anyway. My second sighting was down on the Washougal River, just a couple miles up from Dugan Falls. And, of course, Wes and Woody had their encounter not really that far from that area, too.
See, my dad and his family are from Camas. So, and I used to steelhead fish on the Washougal. Every Christmas I was down here by the bowling alley fishing. I would like to see one of these things, like I said, on my terms. I've asked Wes to basically, what I'd like is if you had information on that area that I hunt up there, I would love to know more about what's going on. I don't want to mention a particular group's name that I'm not really fond of, their website seems to have dried up with some information, and I don't always trust what I read on it. And I think that there's a lot of, the Bigfoot stuff has turned into a circus. And
yeah, it really has.
You know what I mean? And so I'm very leery about who I'm speaking to, or this is the first time. Well, actually, you know who I talked to was Alan Berry. That's who I talked to about 20 years ago. And he sent me a disc with the Sierra Sounds on the recordings that they made up there. and he just wanted me to verify if the sounds I heard were similar to that. And in a way, yes and no, but mostly I thought no. I thought the disc sounded like an angry monkey. And,
right. I listened to that, and it doesn't, what I heard didn't sound anything like that. You're right, yes and no. It's hard to describe what that chattering noise is. You know, when you talk about it, it's forceful.
Yeah, it's not loud. It's not like this. It's not like somebody speaking as loud as they could. It was just a powerful voice, and it was...
Right.
And there's a language there. I do believe they were talking to. They had to have been talking to each other. They had to have been talking to each other. The way the one would respond to the other, you know, and one would stop talking, and another one would pick up and chatter a little bit, and another one would, you know what I mean? And they weren't
right.
Long, drawn-out sentences. They were just, you know, and clicking sound. Only the one made the clicking sound, though. I will give you that. Only one, the one that was directly below my tent, or about 30 yards directly in line from me right there, that one was making the clicking sounds. I don't recall hearing the clicking from the other two. Oh, I got goosebumps just talking about this.
You know, I would suggest that if you would like to, you know, we could all, the three of us, and you can communicate, you know, privately through emails or phone calls about, you know, if you want to know more information and things like that.
Absolutely, yeah. I'd love to. I'm not a Bigfoot hunter. That's not what I intend to ever do. If I ever see one, I always tote a camera with me. I've got a digital camera packed to my hip. If I ever get the chance, that's all I need. And I don't care about making any money on it. I don't want to show the world, here, look, Bigfoot exists. Really don't care. I just want to know for myself.
Because we can certainly help you look for certain things, different signs, things like that, that you've probably seen and didn't know that's what they were.
Well, see, one thing that we have up there where I elk hunt is we've got a lot of those grass pickers up there. You've got a lot of remote hidden camps because a lot of these people are probably illegal. They're back behind closed-off gates, so you know, where they're not supposed to be necessarily with vehicles and so forth.
Right,
and
right.
I've also heard rumors of them stealing coolers and food and stuff like that. So I don't know how much activity or things that I've seen up there that I just automatically attribute to these people. You know what I mean? And,
right. Well, there's things I can show you that won't be people at all. That's okay. Completely different than all that. So that's all I'll say about that while we're on the air.
Gotcha. And, I mean, I just happen to be going through, every once in a while I get moods to, I got to know, and I got to look for something interesting. One particular group who's on TV anymore is just an absolute zoo. I can't stand watching that crap. And I want to see and hear from realistic people. And I just happened to be going to YouTube, and I got lucky and listened to an interview with you three. That interview kind of spooked me because, first of all, I don't think I could have handled that situation, especially by myself unarmed. There's no way I could have done it. And
Wes and Woody had a tough situation they were in, that's for sure.
Yes, they did. But that made me wonder what they were. Why there was three of them the next day in my camp. And it kind of dawned on me. Reality set in 27 years later. Maybe they had ill intent. I don't know.
And, you know, it's interesting, you know, because you were by yourself. And I tell people it's never a good thing to go by yourself. It's, you know, what I mentioned about how I used to have my .357 and my hunting rifle and thinking I was pretty invincible, but I won't go anywhere alone. And, in fact, in that southwest Washington area, there was a place, a friend of mine who is lives in Longview, used to be part of my field crew, has been searching for this lady who was out on a, I want to say, vision quest. She left out of the campground and vanished not far from where Wes and Woody had their encounter. And this has been, I want to say, within the last 30 days or so, and no trace. You know, and you can't say directly that they took her, but, you know, it's not the first time it's happened. A lot of the native peoples on the coast here call them cannibals and said that they would eat people. You know, you get a large predator that's opportunistic, an ambush predator, you know, an easy meal is hard to turn down. So,
well, especially now, look at the time of year. There's
exactly.
Not, what the hell are these things eating? I've often asked myself that. What are these things surviving on?
They eat a lot of things. They're very easily catch deer. They'll eat elk. I had a family friend up by Wilkeson back in 1980 when I was stationed at Fort Lewis, called my parents' house one night. And he says, and now this guy never had a phone. He lived off the grid. So for him to go to town and get a phone was kind of a big deal. So he made a point of calling me because he knew at this point, you know, what my experience has been with the subject. And he says, I just need you to come up. I need to talk to you. So when I got to his house, he said that somebody, an official from the Fish and Game Department, had been their supervisor and asked him if he'd been hearing strange noises. And he played along and said, no, he didn't hear anything, and asked him what it was all about. And the guy says, well, he says, I can't tell anybody, but I'm going to tell you the story. Some mushroom pickers up above, near Sunset Lake, up above Wilkeson, had found corpses that were dismembered. And he said, and the official wording of the report that he saw was dismembered without the use of tools.
Wow.
This guy told me that, you know, he was getting power off the grid without, you know, whatever power company, I think Pacific Bell, no figuring out how he was doing it. But the game warden saw how he was doing it, so he told him, he says, well, if you tell anybody this, I'm going to let them know how you're getting their power and you're going to jail. So that was his threat. So he called me, and I went up there, took my camera, drove up to the area. I did find they had taken the corpses, and part of the corpses were missing. I found plenty of Bigfoot tracks, good ones, blood up there. I sent them to John Green in Canada, the pictures. He says, yeah, those are good Bigfoot tracks. And you know, that was kind of where that one went. It was just an amazing occurrence. So they definitely were following the elk herds. And there was a big herd that lived in that area. We called it the Alder Flats back in those days. And they killed two elk. I don't know how many creatures there were that did it, two or three. One of the areas that I work currently, I call it area number four, there is no deer sign in that area whatsoever, and the area is probably 40, 50 square miles. There are no droppings, no tracks, no anything. Lots of bear up there, and they are scared to death. I've seen bear, you know, black bear are pretty spooky. Nothing like this. These things are terrified, and, you know, 400-pounders easily, and there are lots of them. I see them every time I go in there. Scared to death. So, you know, these guys really don't seem to have a lot of problem finding food.
You know, because I've tried to analyze this stuff in my own mind, you know, and how does an animal that large survive? What are they eating? How do they stay warm? You know what I mean? I mean,
well,
if they're not using tools, they're not dressed, and they're that muscular and lean.
They're probably an older species than we are. In fact, upright walking bipedal primates have been around about 7.5 million years. We're just the last type in the line. These guys probably did very well during the ice age. So cold weather, wet weather doesn't bother them. Every time I found tracks near the snow lines, they're always going up in elevation. So the snow, no effect on them. You kind of have to get out of that human way of thinking about it, because these guys have their own ways of doing things and how they function, how they survive. One thing I did find a couple years ago is that they, because of their size, you know, they feed in solitary fashion. Though they might be in groups of 4 to 6 in a range, and ranges can be hundreds, maybe thousands of square miles. When they move from one area to the next, they split up and spread out a couple miles apart on the average to maximize the food, because if they were in a group and they get a deer, then obviously each individual's not going to get as much value out of that kill as, say, an individual would. And what they'll oftentimes do is they'll lay in wait like a big cat will until, you know, near a game trail where something comes along. They use a quick burst of energy. They're conserving energy while they're waiting. And usually, you know, deer are out feeding at night most of the time, especially when it's clear. They come down off high areas where they're sleeping. They wait near these areas. They get a meal. It's not too difficult to figure out, really, once you really know what you're looking for.
And I think my mind was always, based on some of the old literature that I read when I was younger, they make them out to be vegetarians. You know,
people have a lot of crazy ideas about these things, and most of it's not based on anything except oh, I think they're like a gorilla, so they impose on them what gorillas do, or, you know, all kinds, instead of looking at what the stories say, what the Indians say, what witnesses say, and looking at reality. I mean, you know, chimps aren't vegetarian totally by any means. They'll kill you and kill other chimps, but they'll eat, you know, hunt and kill other monkeys and other animals. So, you know, these guys are obviously eating deer. There's lots and lots of stories of hunters and other people having deer in their rifle sights just to have one come charging out of the brush, grab the deer, and run off with it. So,
okay, it's just, oh my God. I you know, I don't know if I want to, if I really want to know too much more, actually. You know, it's, because like I said, I get back, especially up in that area, that Souixon area and Lewis River area that I hunt. And, I'm, you know where Lone Butte is?
Right.
That's basically the center of my stomping ground up there.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm all over that area. And I'm by myself most of the time. Of course, I have guys at camp and stuff. And but, you know, when I take off in the morning, they don't see me until maybe that evening, you know. And oh,
I actually have, knowing the movements of the creatures in that area, that particular group that sort of haunts that region, during the time you're hunting up there, they're farther south.
I'm glad to hear that.
So your timing is good.
I'm glad to hear that. And these are the kind of things I'd like to know, though, you know, honestly.
When you heard the chatter, I'm kind of jealous that you heard that, because that's something I've never heard. But it's kind of one of those things, careful what you ask for. What was going through your mind when you heard that? And it's kind of a two-part question. What was going through your mind when you heard that? And then looking back 27 years later, what do you think their intent was?
You know, all these years, I thought the intent was they were just curious and maybe wanted food out of the coolers, or they were just curious until I heard you guys' interview. And that changed the way I looked at that. Now I'm wondering that maybe they were kind of sizing me up, thinking I was alone. Because like I said, the first night when Betsy heard everything, she heard just one critter out there. She didn't know. We thought it was a deer. And the second night when it came into my camp and actually moved around, that was one animal. That was one solitary animal. The third night all this stuff took place, when we heard all this, that was three distinct animals. And possibly more, but definitely three that were vocalizing. I don't think they expected Mike there. And I think they expected me alone. And I think they were just, had Mike not been there, an extra car and an extra body been in there, I think they watched him come into camp. And I think they were already there. I think that maybe changed their game plan. I know that sounds kind of ridiculous, but...
No, it doesn't, actually.
No,
and I've mentioned this before about how when these aggressive creatures have encountered people and done things to them, it's not the first day or two they're there. These things will sort of ramp up their aggressiveness each successive day until, you know, they probably feel comfortable enough to go in and do whatever it is they're going to do.
Right. And see, I never looked at it that way until I heard you guys' interview, and I thought, wow, I could have been in a lot of trouble. And,
and you know, one thing that kind of sticks out in my mind too, Will, is not only Weston Lyon's encounter is with Robert, is he didn't freak out. He didn't start yelling, screaming. He didn't start shooting guns. And so that kind of sets them off a little bit, too. They're kind of like, well, these aren't acting like normal guys that would come out and start blasting right away. So they don't know what to think. So they're a little more cautious, I would think.
Exactly. It kind of puts them on notice a little bit.
Oh, this thing, but, you know, the second night when I was there alone and it came into my camp, this thing was literally 3 to 4 feet from my head outside my tent. I mean, when I think about that, oh, my God. This thing was right outside my tent, right next to my goddamn head, and it knew I was there. It knew I was there.
That experience was very similar, if you go back to the encounter that Teddy Roosevelt put in one of his books, where the two trappers rode.
I did read that. I have read that. It's a
frightening story. It's very similar how they were in their lean-to the first night, and it came right up to the mouth of the lean-to.
Isn't that frightening? I mean, it really is.
So
and see, that story, for years, I didn't want to believe. I thought, well, it's just an old mountain man's tale, and it's interesting, you know what I mean?
But yeah, there's parallels though to those behaviors.
Yeah, there are. Wow, gosh, guys, you got me all scared. you relook at this, and the fear. I've never felt fear like that though. When I was laying there, I swear I thought this thing could hear my heartbeat. If that makes you know what I mean.
My heart was
just beating so loud, and I had to maintain, and I had the machete there. I, God forbid, a hand would have reached through that tent. I mean, I'd have cut it off, and, you know, it's, but I wasn't going to go out there to confront it. Wasn't going to do that. I had an idea based on what I heard, what this thing probably is. If it's not a human playing a prank, it has to be this. I, to this day, I don't know what else it could be. I truly, really don't know what else it could be. I'm an experienced hunter. I hike every year. I'm not an ignorant fool. I know what I'm talking about. You know, I know what I heard. I know
and
what
most
I heard.
Hunters do, because they're a little more in tune with the outdoors and the surroundings and animals and different sounds. And, you know, I can relate, you know, because I used to hunt and fish that area too. So, you know, you do know different sounds. And, you know, when you hear two legs, it's two legs.
It's two legs. And, you know, even if it was a bear on two legs, you know damn well the bear, he's not gonna have that fluid gait. Not thump, 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 no. It'll
no,
be
and
more.
They can't walk on two legs very far anyway, so.
See? And when the chatter started, oh, my God, guys. Instantly, the chatter didn't scare me. I think it was more surprise. Am I really hearing what I'm hearing? You know, what the hell is this?
When we ended up by Copper Creek, it was a what the hell moment. What is that?
Yeah, exactly. And
looking back,
yes.
Doesn't it go through your mind a little bit like there was some planning going on?
Well, but yes. The reason I'm agreeing with that statement is because I'm your guys' interview. It changed the way I look at what happened to me, if that makes sense. Before, I thought it was just curious vegetarians coming to check out my camp. Now, I'm not sure it was such an innocent ordeal.
You might have been on the menu.
Right, and I do believe these things are intelligent. I really do. And I think the thing has the ability to reason. If they can speak and they can calculate, and they're obviously not up to our standards, but they are intelligent. They do have a language. They're physically capable of hunting. I don't know why they don't use tools or why they're not clothed. I think that says
because
a little
they don't
bit
need
about.
To.
There you go. I guess
you see that's the reason, because you know with humans, you know, we're not as physically adapted to our surroundings as a lot of creatures are. And if you're something like this that's perfectly well adapted to cold weather, you know, like I said, you know, freezing temperature, snow, they seem to like that. Doesn't bother them at all. Their strength, sheer strength alone in size, they don't need tools. You know, they can rip an animal apart barehanded, no problem. So there's no need to develop those kinds of things, same with, you know, clothing, tools, any of that. And as far as, you know, like making plans, when you guys were talking about, I interviewed a hunter one year who was hunting over, I want to say, just north of Silver Star Mountain. And he was telling me that he was, and I don't remember what road he was on, but he was up deer hunting mid-morning, and he saw one walking down the road a few hundred yards ahead of him. And it kept looking back almost like it was wanting him to follow. So he did follow it, and he followed it for quite a while. And he thought it was odd because it kept turning around looking like, you know, it wanted him to keep following. It would even slow down. And then he happened to catch some movement out of his eye to the left up on this slope just up above the road, and he saw another one hiding behind a log. So he felt like it was a trap, like it was luring him into this trap.
Right.
And he turned and took off.
You know, see, now at that point, that's almost time to shoot. And I don't want to be put in a position to where I have to shoot something like that. I really don't. I don't
and
know.
You know,
if,
your rifle might not be big enough to do anything something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
You know, when you're looking at talking about proportions, you know, where a 30-06 bullet might be more like akin to a 22 with something that size. So what kind of a shot do you take?
And I don't exactly know how much control I'd have. I mean, how much were bullet placement under that kind of duress? I don't, you know, it's
exactly.
You know,
Yeah, I'll tell you what, guys. This has been this has just stirred up a goosebumps. It really has. And I have to reevaluate my hiking and my activities outdoors now. And
just don't go alone.
That's just it. As I do, and I always do. I get bored. I take off, grab the mountain bike, grab the backpack, and off I go. You know, and in the summer, I end up around Mount Adams all the time.
Oh, that was always one of my favorite areas.
And I love it up there. It's beautiful. And
it is beautiful.
My home away from home is still around Lone Butte and up in the boonies up there. I mean, I've the Hard Time Creek area, Old Man's Pass. I'm talking. I hunt the entire area. And so
we'll have to be in touch away from there because there's some things I'd like you to watch for in those areas.
Oh, absolutely. I'll tell you what, you guys. Anything you need me to do while I'm up there, I'd be happy to do it. And I'd be more than happy to help you.
Yeah, and I want to thank you, Robert, for coming on. I mean, we really do appreciate it. Like I told you before, it's so hard to get hunters, especially hunters for whatever reason, it's hard to get them to come out and share their encounter. You know, it's like I told you before, I mean, we have a lineup of emails from people who, you know, want to share the UFO, Bigfoot, you know, the UFO dropped a Bigfoot in the area and all those type of stories. But legitimate stories like yours, it's tough to get people to come out and talk about them. And, you know, I really do appreciate you coming on the show and sharing your encounter with us.
Glad you guys actually listened and not ridiculed me. And that's one of those things. My dad, he absolutely refuses to believe in this. So my dad doesn't even know about this encounter. We've kept a secret from him, and I hunt up there with him, you know. And but we don't talk Bigfoot in camp. He just refuses to hear it. And
bring your pops up to Muppet Mountain. We'll show him a few things.
I'll tell you what, guys. I don't know if I could handle what you guys went through. It's incredible. It absolutely is incredible. You guys have actually seen these things. I mean, it's something that I was too chicken shit to get out of my tent and look at. I did not want to see what I thought I was going to see. You know what I mean?
I don't think you want to when you do encounter it. It's like I found tracks when I was 14 back in 1972 in Graham. And, you know, we had never heard the word Bigfoot. And
right.
Same thing, you know, my parents, everybody ridiculed us for that. So we didn't talk about it after that. And about a year and a half or so later, one evening, my dog was going crazy right about dusk, so I figured it was a raccoon or something. You know, he was barking at us. So I grabbed a .22 and a couple of bullets, and I let him go from his dog house and told him to go get him. And I went with him out to the tree line, and he froze and turned around and come running back past me as fast as he could. Now, that dog never backed down from anything. He ran to the porch and sat there shivering, so I thought, what in the hell is that dog doing?
Right.
So I chambered around, and I thought, well, maybe there was a porcupine or something in the tree line. So there were some low-hanging branches, and I had my rifle in my right hand, and I pushed my way through the low branches with the other hand, and I walked into this clearing under a big maple tree. And here was this 8-foot-tall, 800-pound, hair-covered thing standing less than 15 feet in front of me, moving leaves with its right foot. And if that isn't a... You know,
what the hell is this moment?
It stopped and it just glared at me. And I
what
was
did
just
you
like,
think when that thing looked at you? I mean, what was...
My mind went blank.
Imagine.
My skin went cold and I just thought, oh my God, you know, what the hell is this? You know, because I've hunted since I was a little kid, you know, bear and everything. And I just thought, you know, things go through your mind in milliseconds. And
right.
I thought, oh, that must be one of the things that made the tracks. We found three sets of tracks together. So I thought, what do I do now? Because I'm pretty damn close to this thing.
Right.
And having been around, you know, my dad helping him butcher and things, I was pretty well what things weighed, you know, of course hunting elk and deer and everything. And I knew it was at least 800 pounds. And I thought, well, I don't have my hunting rifle or shotgun, so this .22 isn't going to do anything to that. So I shot in the air just to see what it would do, hoping maybe it would, you know, go away or something. And I heard a noise from my right rear. And I turned my head slightly, still trying to keep an eye on this thing in front of me. And I heard this thing walk out from behind some brush, and it was another one that walked over and stood next to the first one. And it was about a head shorter, a couple hundred pounds lighter. And they just, both of them just glared at me, and it was not a happy look. And at that moment, I just, you know, terror gripped me, and I just took off running for the house.
Can I ask you all a question real quick?
Yeah.
Because you have seen these things. You've seen their faces.
Right.
Does this thing look like the Roger Patterson film? Is that a real one?
Yes, that is a real one.
That's what I thought. I was always, you watch all this crap video, you see all this crap online, and that's what it is. It's absolute crap. And
you're absolutely right about that.
The only thing that I thought might be real was the Roger Patterson flick, and I've always wondered
about that.
You guys, I'll tell you what, man. Thank you very much for listening to me. And like I said, this is a true story. It's not a lie. I have no reason to lie about it.
Robert, thanks for sharing it with us. We certainly appreciate it.
Absolutely.
And if I could help you guys, or if you have any more questions, or if you need me to do some scouting while I'm out,
by all means, keep in touch with us. We'll share some information with you. You know, give you a little more education. Some real stuff, not the junk that's out there.
Right. I'd appreciate that. I really would. Absolutely. I'd appreciate that. Thank you, guys. And like I said, if there's anything I can do for you, please don't hesitate to ask. And I swear to God, I will never interfere with any of your activities or anything like that. But if you need me to do something, just let me know.
Sure. Oh, no. We'll talk again. We're going to talk again in the future. I guarantee that. Yeah.
Hey, guys. Thanks again. I do appreciate it.
All right, Robert. Thank you for joining the show tonight, and you have a good night.
You too.
Have a good night, Robert.
Thanks, Robert. Good, solid account.
Yeah, really good account. It's tough to come out and share a story. It's really tough to come out and share a story with complete strangers, because you never know how people are going to react. You know what I mean?
It's taken him 27 years to come out and talk about that. So that tells you a lot right there.
I'd love to have him back. I think he's a stand-up guy. I believe his story. One of the best interviews we've had so far, I would say.
Nope, he was awesome, that's for sure.
And I know we burned up a lot of time with his interview, and I wanted to give him time to, you know, as much time as he wanted to come on the air and talk about it. I know we're running really short on time, and I know we wanted to get into the burial sites. Before I get into that, Will, did you see the preview for the $1 million Bigfoot bounty?
No, I didn't.
I got a clip of the upcoming show I want to play for you guys real quick and get your guys' take on it. But this is the $10 million Bigfoot bounty that's coming to Spike. So tell me what you guys think of this real quick.
Hey, everybody.
Hey!
We're going to get to know each other quite well over the next several weeks. How many people here have seen Bigfoot? How about your sighting?
I saw him right on a ridgeline walking nonchalantly through this, like, meadow. He seemed to lean forward. I knew it was not a man. It was way too weird. As I yelled for my brother and my cousin to go get binoculars, I got to observe him for 3 to 5 more minutes just walking very slowly towards this huge dark tree line.
What time of day was this?
It was right before dusk.
Okay. How about anybody else?
I've shot and killed 2 of them.
Can you tell me about it?
I was bear hunting. I was with my buddy. We're out there. It's just a normal day. We saw something. So I shot it.
Justin is a little crazy. He needs to be on meds. I'm a little nervous about being outside with him on a hunt tomorrow.
I've done everything I could do to try to prove that I'm telling the truth. All that I can do now is go try to get another one.
You know what's funny about that audio? There's two things that I thought of during that audio. One is I'm kind of shocked by everyone in the group. Like, they play the, Justin Smidge is like, or Smeal, however you say his name. He's like, I shot 2 of them, and it's like, bum, bum, bum. You know, and everyone kind of jumps in. There's like this hush over the crowd, like no one's ever heard his story before.
Yeah.
Kind of off topic, but you go back and watch that. I'll post it up on Facebook. But if you go back and watch that, the first thing that I went through my mind was, I realized Justin Smihaz, you know, he's a solid B cup.
I
come on, guy. Really? Really?
It's hard to believe that we're a world power after watching.
At least the sea. That's all I gotta say.
He might be a small sea. Mm-hmm. He's definitely a solid yeah. B, but he might be a small sea cup.
Yeah.
That guy is so full of crap on his story. You know, I talked to him. I was set up with his, I got his phone number through a mutual contact just a few months after his supposed, incident. And so I sat and talked to him and made a bunch of notes. And now I look at his story or listen to it, and I'm thinking, this guy changed all kinds of stuff. You know, where he says he tracked the adult. So he didn't do any of that.
It's hard to focus on.
I don't believe he ever shot anything. Maybe a bear up there.
It's hard to focus on a story with those bosoms.
I guess
sidetracked.
There aren't any guy boobs that would ever distract my attention like that. It'd have to be the real thing.
Oh, man. So,
you're so going to hell, you know that, right?
You're so going to hell. So, do you guys think we should cover the Sasquatch burying their dead next time?
I think we should do it next time. Yeah.
Yeah. Since we burned up a lot of time.
I'll dig up a little more information, you know, for some background on it, too.
But I thought you guys would enjoy Robert's story. I mean, I really enjoyed talking to him.
No, it was great. It turned out really good.
I thought it was awesome. But
yeah, I think it's one of the best interviews we've had, don't you guys think?
Yeah, he did a good job. And it's nice being able to get a hunter, you know, and to tell their story.
True, very true.
It's like I told you guys about the guy that I was, back in 87 or so, I was up there, we had kids up, and he had his family and kids up playing in the snow up around the Washougal River area, and he's the guy that asked me if I was getting any good shots, and I told him what I was doing, and he told me about him and his buddies in their hunting camp, and the very same Sasquatch that I had seen, previously in that area was the one that came into their camp and stood there and looked at him. That had been 17 years before we talked, and he hadn't even told his wife about that incident.
Yeah,
Robert told his story, it's like, okay, here's another parallel.
Yeah.
You can find all kinds of parallels when you talk to different witnesses. You know, the more people you talk to over time, you can always reach back in your bag of tricks there and pull out stories that you've heard before eerily similar to the ones that new people tell you about.
No, we might have to do two shows this week, boys. I know we missed out last week, and a lot of people were asking us if we would do two shows, but I know we wanted to get to do Sasquatch Bury Their Dead, but I know with Robert's encounter, I didn't think it was going to take that long, but I wanted him to take as much time as he wanted to share his encounter.
Good, solid show.